If you are over 50, there's things that you need to know about your gut that aren't as important to people that are under 50. And I'm talking about your microbiome, I'm talking about your gut integrity, I'm talking about signaling devices and your overall metabolism. It's just different. So I'm gonna paint a picture. I've got five things that everyone over 50 should know about their gut and their microbiome. The first thing to address is that the world of microbiome and longevity research is in its infancy, okay? I would be lying if I told you that the microbiome is, there's particular things associated with longevity. The fact is that the microbiome changes radically as we get older, okay? For instance, there's one thing that's really wild. In younger people, we see that, okay, there's a certain kind of bacteria called Bacteroidetes, okay? Now, Bacteroidetes are largely associated with lean people, healthy people, fast metabolisms, good glucose utilization. But then when you look at a study that's published in Nature Metabolism, you find that elderly people, not just people over 50, but just to use an example, elderly like 80 and up, they found high levels of Bacteroidetes actually were associated with being closer to death. That's not exactly something we want, right? Why could this be happening? Well, it could be the fact that yes, Bacteroidetes is associated with a fast, good, lean metabolism. But as we get older, maybe we don't want so much of that when we get into our elderly years. Maybe we want things to slow down so we're not just burning through our protein, burning through our muscle, because sarcopenia and age-related sarcopenia, muscle wasting is largely correlated with, well, you know what. So anyway, that's just an important thing to note. To throw the microbiome into the research world of longevity is almost like a cruel sick joke because it adds so many different variables to an already complicated science. Anyhow, that's not that interesting. Let's move into some things that you can do. Okay, so the second thing is your gut wall integrity is probably the most important thing that you could pay attention to. Eli Metchkanoff back in the day had talked about how the gut wall is probably the biggest link to aging. Now these are his words, but he associates a gut being permeable, meaning our intestines allowing things to leak through that shouldn't leak through, is probably the biggest link to aging. And that makes sense, right? As we get older, our gut gets weaker and more pathogenic materials can pass through into our bloodstream, triggering an immunological response, an inflammatory response that has an effect on our entire body and all of our different functions. That definitely could wreak some havoc as we get older. There's a study that was published in the journal Medical Microbiology that found that there was a direct reciprocal relationship between gut dysbiosis and gut wall integrity, meaning if gut wall integrity was bad, the gut microbiome was bad. If the gut microbiome was bad, the gut wall integrity was bad. So it triggers this cascading like steamroller effect of if your gut wall is bad, your microbiome is bad, and it just gets worse and worse and worse. So how do we stop it? We stop a runaway train by taking care of our gut wall. So we do that by avoiding emulsifiers. If you can't pronounce the name of something that's in your ingredients, you need to avoid it if you're over 50, okay? Emulsifiers, things like that are not good to have in the equation. Phytic acids, do not eat raw nuts. Roast them and sprout them ideally. Specifically things like almonds, okay, because they're rich in phytic acid. Phytic acid is an anti-nutrient and it can break down our gut wall. It may not have an effect on you today, but it can have an effect over time. So be very cognizant of that. Another one is trans fats, partially hydrogenated. A lot of breads have those in them, a lot of peanut butters, almost all fast food. Partially hydrogenated oils, they're in so many things, they break down our gut wall, which has a huge effect on our gut microbiome as we get older. But there's some good news, there's things you can have that actually support it. Pomegranate, for instance. A little bit of pomegranate juice is great for the gut wall. Green tea, especially matcha, is phenomenal for the gut wall. Chickpeas contain a very specific compound in them that trigger the expression of genes that tighten our cell junctions, our gut wall junctions. So things like chickpea pasta or chickpeas now and then can literally help improve the integrity of your gut wall. The next thing is diversity is still important. Okay, just because a certain bacteria is associated with a certain thing doesn't mean that diversity isn't important. I want to give you an example. Let's say you've got a group of 100-year-old people and they all seem to have an increase in this one bacteria. And that says, well, wait a minute, they're 100 years old, so that increase in bacteria must mean that that's a good bacteria. It could be the case, but here's another thing to consider. We have an immune system, an immune response called immunoglobulin A, IgA. It's the job of IgA in our gut to regulate pathogenic bacteria. If our IgA signaling is weak, if our immune system is weaker, couldn't that, as we get older, this happens, couldn't that mean that this IgA is allowing pathogenic bacteria to get elevated? So maybe that's why we see an increase in certain bacteria, not because it's supposed to be there, but because a weakened system is allowing it to be there? My point in saying that is we shouldn't be looking at individual strains, we should be looking at diversity as we get older. It's a very, very important thing. An interesting study and something to pay attention to as you're over the age of 50, community and who you surround yourself around becomes crazy important. This is not some weird woo-woo witch doctor nonsense. This is real stuff, okay? This study published that when you took a look at people that were in a community versus people that were just in some kind of assisted living, their gut microbiomes were drastically different, much more diverse with a community. Probably because of serotonin and just benefit and relationship, but also shaking hands with people, communicating, hugging, that all transfers skin microbiomes, which has an effect on our gut microbiome. You might be wondering, by the way, like about probiotics, things like that. I'm not gonna say that any one probiotic is going to come in and save the day, but the one that I usually recommend when people ask me is one called Seed, and I put a link down below. They're doing a lot of the research with the microbiome, so I appreciate the heck out of that because they're putting their best foot forward and actually putting their money where their mouth is by taking proceeds and putting it into more research. It's the one that I use, the one that I generally recommend. There's a special link down below using the code THOMAS15. You can save 15% if you want to try them out because they are a supporter of this channel just because we love what each other talks about. So we have a synergistic relationship. So use that link down below if you want to try them as a probiotic. I would reckon that they're pretty darn solid for just about any age group. But as always, you want to make sure it's the right thing for you. So there's a link down below in the description after you watch this video. The next one is very, very important. Short chain fatty acid production decreases as you age. So what do you do about it? Okay, short chain fatty acids are the byproduct of having bacteria. The bacteria feed on food and they produce short chain fatty acids. Short chain fatty acids signal all kinds of things. I cannot overemphasize how important that is. They signal our genes to do things. They signal our brain to do things. They signal healthy metabolisms. Without short chain fatty acids, all that diminishes. It is so important. But why do short chain fatty acids diminish with age? The biggest piece is probably our caloric intake changes. We decrease our caloric intake and we see a direct correlation with short chain fatty acids decreasing. How do we change that? I don't want to just say eat more, because for a lot of people, that's the last thing we need. But we do need to change the abundance of the fibers that we're bringing in to try to encourage that in spite of having, well, maybe potentially lower caloric intake. I would usually recommend consuming some relatively oddball things now and then. Plantains contain specific kinds of starches that grow more short chain fatty acids, more bacteria that create short chain fatty acids. Green bananas, yes, literally green bananas, and having green banana flour, which they make because it is a thing and it works. So if you eat like a quarter of a green banana, it really doesn't even taste that bad. Put it in your oatmeal, whatever. It can plant the seed for a lot of good bacteria to grow and a lot of short chain fatty acid production. Also, sprouted cashews, because the sprouting removes the phytic acid and the cashews have a lot of those fermentable fibers in them, as well as artichokes, long chain inulin. Okay, so artichokes, cashews, the green banana, the plantain, and even one that gets a lot of a bad rap sometimes, which I really don't understand why, chicory root. That is a very important one as well. This next one is polyphenols, but it's so frustrating because people don't talk about how polyphenols actually get absorbed. Polyphenols, all these benefits that we get from our berries, from our fruits, from our capers, from a lot of nutrient-rich vegetables, we don't actually absorb the polyphenols. We only absorb 5 to 10% of the polyphenols directly through the small intestine. The rest go down to the colon, get acted upon by our microbes, and we absorb the metabolites of the polyphenols. The metabolites, the byproduct of our microbiome breaking down polyphenols, are what does the magic. So we're talking in this case, things like berries, things like chocolates, things like hazelnuts, and things like capers, which contain quercetin, which is very, very powerful. Now, when it comes to berries, modest amounts of berries, okay, there's a study published in the journal Nature, it demonstrated that berries contain a specific kind of polyphenol metabolite that can cross through the blood-brain barrier And when it crosses the blood-brain barrier, it can help modulate the inflammatory response that is created by what's called the microglia. The microglia is the immune system in our brain. It's contained in our brain. And sometimes it gets overactive and it can cause neurodegenerative issues. I'm not saying that polyphenols are going to come in and save the day. I think sometimes we rely way too much on food to do magical things for us. But there's a lot of evidence that demonstrates that yes, getting these polyphenols in tandem with a good microbiome can have such a profound effect on how we feel in our brain. So yes, if you're over 50, you should be paying attention to these polyphenols, but they don't do you a whole lot of good unless you're also having the fiber and taking care of the gut. As always, please keep it locked in here on my channel, and I will see you tomorrow.